but they don't know a lot about World Youth Day, or they maybe not be Catholic, but they're very excited that this is happening.
Not unlike that that Muslim woman that works at that gelato place that we go to all
That's
the time,
right.
And she's probably the happiest person I've seen about World Youth Day, and she loves the Pope, and she's just really
right.
happy that there's all this joy
right.
Surrounding the city.
Right.
Yeah.
And people have asked about, you know, what's the press been like, and how is the local
yeah.
how's the local press, and certainly our viewers can go online and look at some of the different local papers, but I think certainly you saw a difference from yesterday to today's headlines. Lots of different pictures of the arrival. Somebody had made a mention that, you know, it's a religious event, but it's also a state event, and
it
so
is.
That's worthy of attention. And the real focus is, you know, what brings all of these young people from all over the world to be present to the Holy Father, and certainly the press is starting to capture some of those stories. And so there really is a very positive and kind of electric feel that's happening at this time.
You know what, where you can see it is with the meal plans. I was thinking about that last night because we were at the restaurant, and there was a group of pilgrims that were behind us that started doing their pilgrim chant,
yeah,
and
right.
I thought, there's all these patrons that are sitting here that probably would like to have a quieter dinner,
right.
But nobody seemed to be terribly annoyed. Everybody was having a good time. The waiters seemed to be okay.
Right.
And, I mean, so many restaurants that are accepting the pilgrim coupons, I mean, right there shows how many people in the city, businesses, are embracing
right.
Just the idea of all these pilgrims. And it's not just because it's business.
Right.
They want to support these young people who
yeah,
are here
do.
Because they're standing for what they believe.
You know, and the Holy Father has actually had a pretty busy day today. And so I'd like to,
yeah.
to highlight two of the trips that he made to the outskirts of the city. The Holy Father went to the Basilica of the Monastery of San Lorenzo, in Del
Escorial, yes.
to visit women's young religious and also young university professors. And in the conversation that he had, or the homily that he gave to the women's young religious, we talked about gospel radicalism, and we're seeing some of those clips here. And I thought the concept of gospel radicalism was a very interesting and very fitting theme for this particular World Youth Day.
It is, because most people, we think of the word radical as something that's negative, all those radicals, but really to be a radical is to be someone that's in touch with their roots, someone
right.
who is rooted, because radix is Latin for root.
That's right.
So to be a radical is to be rooted,
which
in
brings
your beliefs.
Us back to our theme, to be rooted and built up and firm in our faith. And so certainly we had a chance to talk with some of the young women religious who were actually there, and they got back and they were just thrilled and very excited.
Yes. So this is something that is new for World Youth Day. I don't believe the Holy Father has met with religious women or had a special meeting just for them. Or
just for the women's religious. No, I think this is a first time.
And it's also a first time that he meets with
university professors. Which was a meeting that he talked about. He said he was really excited. He was looking forward to this meeting with young university professors. And I have to say, as a university chaplain myself, I appreciated that. And
he's a professor, yes.
Right. And there he cautioned the university professors about, that they should not be caught up in purely technical abilities or utilitarian approaches to education, but rather that they should really embrace the full human experience. He talked about university as the concept of a house. And actually at one point had quoted Plato and said that, quoted Plato and said that we should seek the truth while we are young, for it is only then, for if we don't do it then, that it will escape our grasp.
Right.
And at the same time, he recognized that it will never really escape our grasp, we'll never fully grasp it, because truth is something that we can never possess fully, but in fact that truth is something that we are possessed by.
Did you get a sense that he spoke differently to the university professors as academics, or in a Benedict fashion that he was speaking the way he speaks?
But I think Benedict is always a teacher, and he's very approachable, and that's something I certainly have appreciated from Pope Benedict. Is very approachable and he's very accessible in terms
yeah.
of his language and speech. But certainly he recognized that he was in the presence of intellectuals and spoke to them on a very intellectual level. You certainly don't hear him quoting Plato a whole lot
no,
to the kids.
No, not exactly.
Yes. But but certainly was trying to put a real emphasis on the importance of an education of the whole person and the holistic approach to education, and cautioning very much against getting too stuck in trade education or technical education, that really education is something that is all much more encompassing than
well,
than
in
what
the true
we
sense
of
Catholic education, that,
right.
that's sort of what liberal education really is.
Right.
Do you, as a teacher yourself, but do you sense that this is something that Pope Benedict will continue doing, meeting with professors at World Youth Days or every country that he goes?
You never know. I mean, I would certainly like to. I would certainly say that he has a great respect for teachers. We've seen that he, and as I mean, it was mentioned earlier in the trip to London. At that, when he went to London, he certainly
yeah.
visited with teachers of schools and with students actually there as well. So he's always tried. I think you see an ever growing connection with our Catholic institutions. And he actually referenced in this talk a recent trip to Avila, in which
right.
he had a symposium of sorts on the mission of a Catholic university. And so he referenced that in the homily today, or in the address today.
Is it fair to say that he it's important for him to meet with professors, not because he himself is a professor, but because there's something else? I mean, teachers,
these are the people that are going to be forming the students. When these students leave, and when these young people leave World Youth Day, they're going to be going back to their homes, and they're
yes.
going to be in the hands of the local priests and the teachers of Catholic institutions. And so to make sure that there is an address to them, I think is a very fitting piece to World Youth Day, is to address not just the students, but also the teachers of the students. And so certainly you saw that
In fact, in the images that we're looking, it looks, I mean, these are professors, but a lot of them look very young.
They are young professors.
Young professors.
Right.
It wasn't just any old, and I don't mean that because they're old, but any old professor is specifically
right.
meeting with young professors. fascinating. We are approaching the time of the beginning of the Way of the Cross. Pilgrims have been gathering already. Not far from the papal welcome ceremony took place last night, the Cibeles Square. It's not exactly there, but I believe that's where the Way of the Cross begins.
Right.
The road is called El Paseo de Recoletos, main portion of a main road here in central Madrid. And you'll notice that the Way of the Cross is going to be a little different.
Yeah, I'm actually really excited to see this version of the Via Crucis, because it really does represent a lot of the Spanish tradition. I've been reading up on things all day long, and I have to say that for our viewers in North America, this is going to be different than anything they've ever experienced, unless they've
yeah.
come someplace
yeah,
here.
Yeah. So, but I don't want to give too much away, because we'll let the images show for themselves. That's going to take place in about 45 minutes. But to help us prepare to enter into this mystery, really, of the Passion of
right.
Christ through the mystery through the Stations of the Cross, Father Tom Rozica is actually right now inside on the main stage at the Palacio de Deportes, he's going to lead the young people that are in the Palacio through a reflection that's going to help them also enter into the mystery. And we'll be able to bring you that reflection as well through television. But before that, we need to remember the meaning of the cross, because the cross is an important element of our Christian faith, but also of World Youth Days, the World Youth Day cross. So let's remember the World Youth Day cross.
In 1984, the year of the Holy Redemption, Pope John Paul II entrusted the cross of Christ to the youth of the world. He said, "Take it around the world as a sign of the love of the Lord Jesus for humanity. Proclaim to all, Christ is risen. There is salvation and redemption." Since then, this wooden cross, 4 meters high, has become the most recognizable symbol of World Youth Day. Young people have taken the World Youth Day cross behind the Iron Curtain. It's been to Ground Zero in New York, to Rwanda after the genocide, and the cross has traveled to the demilitarized zone that separates the people of North and South Korea. Wherever it goes, it declares Christ victorious, proclaiming life in the face of death. The World Youth Day cross has been passed from one nation to the next. It's been on 5 continents, from Canada to the farthest reaches of the globe in Australia and New Zealand. In 2003, on Palm Sunday, Pope John Paul II introduced an icon of Our Lady to accompany the cross on its pilgrimage. He gave the icon as a symbol of Mary's maternal presence, close to young people. Mary teaches us to follow the cross as she accompanies us on our pilgrim journey through life. The cross and icon have been carried, touched, and kissed by millions of people throughout the world. And the tradition continues. On Palm Sunday 2009, Pope Benedict XVI handed the World Youth Day Cross and Icon to the young people of Spain. During this past year, the World Youth Day Cross and Icon have been on pilgrimage across Spain. Together, pilgrims have walked with Mary in a spirit of reconciliation and service under the cross. Together, the cross and icon are eternal reminders of the sacred blood of Christ poured out in love for the world. Imitate St. John of the Cross, cling to God in the face of persecution, turn every suffering into an opportunity to grow in holiness, and trust in the guidance of our Blessed Mother. St. John of the Cross, pray for us.
Now, before we go to Father Tom's reflection inside the Palacio, seeing those images of the World Youth Day Cross, I don't know about you, but I've been with that cross so many times and carried it and touched it and cried with it.
Right, I agree. As I was commenting before, I mean, this is being with the cross. I was there when it came into to Australia, and it was really just it's a very powerful moment. And as it came into the Palacio here earlier, a very powerful moment and a lot of emotions associated with the cross.
Absolutely. Now, Father Tom is ready up on stage on the main stage in the Palacio. So we're going to go begin preparing to enter into this mystery of the Stations of the Cross.
...du Canada qui nous rejoindre ce soir ici au Palacio de Deportes au cœur de Madrid pour la Journée Mondiale de la Jeunesse. I welcome all of you, especially our television viewers in Canada who join us through Salt and Light Television, live, who join us through our internet web streaming. Bienvenido a todos que han venido aquí esta noche para participar a la Via Cruces de Madrid, de la Jornada Mundial de la Juventud. Benvenuti a tutti che sono venuti stasera a partecipare alla Via Crucis qui, in questo centro, Palacio de Deportes, al cuore della Giornata Mondiale della Gioventù a Madrid. Ich grüße alle, die sind hier heute Abend gekommen, am Abteilen unserer Kreuzweg. Herzlich willkommen. Dieses Programm ist nach Kanada in Fernsehen in diesem Moment. I would ask you just to calm down. And if you have the prayer book, the Magnificat prayer book, you can take out the Magnificat prayer book. Nous allons suivre le chemin de croix ce soir dans votre Magnificat que vous avez reçu dans les sacs des pèlerins. And in the English version, it begins on page 221. So just have your finger in there and hold the book ready. The reason why we didn't announce this morning is because we only got the confirmation from the satellite after the Mass was over at the catechesis. So we used social networking to spread the word, and I think it worked. So if you can lower the flags, not to obstruct the view. We're very grateful to Vatican Television, which is going to be sending us the live satellite beginning promptly at 7:30. So I will stop speaking and we'll switch over to what's being broadcast around the world tonight. À 7 heures pile, nous allons rejoindre le chemin de croix de Madrid, pas loin d'ici, et nous remercions la télévision du Vatican et le Père Lombardi. The Vatican has also sent us shortly, a little while ago, the text of the Holy Father in English, which he will pronounce at the end of the Stations of the Cross. I will be reading that to you once the Pope has spoken that text in Spanish. So let's begin. We can just come to silence for a moment. And I want to explain to you what this wonderful devotion is of the Stations of the Cross, the Via Crucis. I will be speaking in English this evening. In order to understand the Stations of the Cross, we have to turn our hearts and minds to Jerusalem. Jerusalem is the city of the historical Via Dolorosa, the sorrowful way. Jerusalem alone has this great and tragic privilege. The Via Dolorosa today, as we know it in Jerusalem, that you often see in images and on television, is defined more by faith than by history. During the medieval times, pilgrims returning from Jerusalem, going back to their homelands, their countries, wanted to reproduce the holy places in their own cities, thus enabling many people, many others, who didn't have the opportunity to go to the Holy Land to share the same spiritual experiences that they had in the holy city of Jerusalem. While I did my own graduate studies in sacred scripture, I lived on the Via Dolorosa. My address, in fact, was number 2. I lived at the second station. Imagine telling your friends, "Where do you live?" "I live at the second station where Pilate tried Jesus." That was the complex that I lived in. And I saw every morning, every afternoon, and every evening, thousands and thousands of pilgrims from all over the world who walked the sorrowful way of Jesus. The Via Crucis, the Via Dolorosa, as we have it today, dates back to the medieval period. And it's especially associated with St. Bernard of Chiaravalle, an Italian, a Franciscan. It's associated with St. Francis of Assisi and St. Bonaventure of Bagnoregio. In the year 1233, the Order of Friars Minor, the Franciscans, established themselves in the Holy Land, and they became the custodians of the holy places. And thank God that they have stayed in the Holy Land and maintained these places and kept the memory of Jesus alive. It is not an easy mission, and we owe them our great gratitude and our respect and our affection. At the end of the 13th century, the Via Crucis is mentioned not as a pious exercise, but as the way that Jesus walked up to Calvary. Several stations started to be identified, and this is, remember, the 13th century. Little by little, people said, this is the place that commemorates that moment, and this commemorates that moment. And in the year 1294, a Dominican friar, an Italian, by the name of Rinaldo di Montecrucis, in his pilgrim book that he wrote, a pilgrim guidebook, he wrote that when he was in Jerusalem, he went up to the Holy Sepulchre on the same way that Jesus walked, carrying his cross. That's one of the first times that we hear a pilgrim describing that there was something in Jerusalem that was retracing the steps of Jesus. He also described some of the places that he saw on his pilgrimage. He saw, for example, the palace of Herod, the Lithostrotos. Remember in John's Gospel in chapter 19, Pilate took Jesus out and sat him down on the stone pavement, Lithostrotos. That's the place where I lived in Jerusalem. The place where Jesus met the women of Jerusalem on the way. The place where Simon of Cyrene picked Jesus' cross up on his shoulders to help him carry that. So notice, this is a later devotion. This didn't start right after the apostolic period. It didn't start in the time of the Acts of the Apostles. 12 centuries went by, and suddenly this Franciscan went back and wrote about the places he remembered, and he named them. Now, the way of the cross as we know it today, the one that you see in many of your churches and in your chapels and in pictures and images, is a coming together. It's a fusion of three different devotions that were widespread at the 15th century. So after the Franciscan went in the 13th century, 200 years went by, and then in the 15th century, these devotions started to spring up in different parts of Europe. The first devotion that sprung up was a devotion to the times that Christ fell under the way of the cross. And in the first devotion, it said that he fell seven times. Notice what we have in our devotion today. Christ falls the first time, the second time, and then the final time. The second devotion that was at work in the 15th century was called the devotion to the sorrowful way of Christ. And it consisted at first of processions to churches, to different churches, sometimes to seven different churches. The number seven was very important. It's important in the scriptures, and it was important in the development of these devotions. And the processions in this particular devotion marked Jesus' processions. Somebody read the text of the Passion, and they said, we counted seven different processions. The first one was from Gethsemane to the house of Annas, then from the house of Annas to the house of Caiaphas. Then Jesus' walk to the Praetorium of Pontius Pilate. Then his walk to the palace of Herod. And then his walk finally to the cross. These moments that were marked here, that were kept alive in people's minds, showed that when people went to the Holy Land, they were reading the scriptures literally. They read every line, every sentence, and said, if it says it here, this is what Jesus did. Fortunately, the devotions came together, and there was a third devotion, the devotion to the stations of Christ. These were the moments in which Christ stopped on the way to Calvary. He stopped because the burden was so heavy. He stopped because of exhaustion. He was moved by love and compassion in order to talk to the women who were there. These were marked by pillars. So what happens is you have three different traditions that were alive, and they marked three different ways of reading the scriptures. The way of the cross as we know it today, with the 14 stations, did not come to us really from the Holy Land, nor from Italy. It came from Spain, right in this country. It was first attested to in Spain in the first half of the 17th century, especially in the areas where Franciscans were present. The Franciscans knew about the Holy Land. Their brothers were caring for the shrines there. And thank God that they took all of this blend of devotions and all these different traditions, and they put them together for us in 14 different stations. For the Madrid Way of the Cross, which we're going to experience tonight with hundreds of thousands of people, with the people of Spain and with the Holy Father, 14 stations will be depicted. But unlike the Stations of the Cross that many of us experienced at Toronto's World Youth Day in 2002, or the magnificent stations in Sydney in 2008, and both evenings we will never, ever forget, tonight's stations will not involve actors or people portraying the roles of Jesus and Mary Magdalene and Judas and all of the players of the Stations of the Cross. What they've done is gone around the country of Spain and brought together magnificent sculptures that are part of the Spanish tradition of Holy Week. No country has produced such powerful images of Jesus crucified, of Jesus suffering, of Jesus carrying the cross than Spain. It's a rich part of the church in Spain. And so from Malaga to Zamora, from Valladolid to Murcia, from churches and all these confraternities, which would be like parish organizations, they've offered the best of their sculptures. In fact, there was a big contest that took place here in the country over the past months to see which city would offer their sculpture for that particular Stations of the Cross. And the stations are going to take place on a street not far from here, on the Paseo de Recoletos that many of you have walked on over the past few days. And the sculptures are on like trolleys. And the men of the towns of these different sculptures will be carrying the sculptures on their shoulders. And it's an extraordinary privilege for these men to be carrying these sculptures. This is not just somebody that's yanked in from the crowd or, hey, you, come and help. These are men who belong to the ancient confraternities of Spain. Each of the towns here and the cities had wonderful traditions of confraternities, groups, men's groups, that were responsible for different services in the local churches. The Way of the Cross will certainly be a highlight tonight because of its graphic beauty, its eloquence, its history, its art, and the piety and emotion that it really invites from all of us. That's why I'm very happy that so many of you are here tonight. It would have been wonderful to follow this, but the street is very small outside, and you would have been spread out quite far in the very distances. So we join ourselves in prayer tonight with the people that will be praying outside. What do the stations represent for us as we see these different images? Tonight you're going to be seeing, for example, here, the first station will begin with the Last Supper, followed by the station of the Kiss of Judas, the denial of St. Peter. They're all in your book that you have before you. Jesus taking up his cross. So notice, some of these are the traditional 14, and some of them are taken from the scriptures in the Passion narrative. Jesus falling under the weight of the cross. Jesus helped by the Cyrenian. Veronica wiping the face of Jesus. Jesus being stripped of his garments. The crucifixion. Jesus dying on the cross. Jesus taken down from the cross. Jesus in the arms of his mother. The magnificent image of the Pietà. Jesus buried. And the 15th station is going to highlight a very important element of Spanish tradition and piety, Our Lady of Sorrows. So tonight, when we're watching these statues, we're praying to the stories behind these statues and to the Blessed Mother and to Jesus and to all of those people who were involved at one moment of history in a tragic interplay, an interplay of persons, a struggle between light and darkness, between truth and falsehood. And along the way of the cross, the evangelists Luke and John in particular offer us models who teach us to live our daily lives, Jesus's passion is a journey toward the resurrection. Let me plant some seeds in your mind tonight as we prepare to enter this ancient and beautiful devotion. Think of some of the characters. You know them well. We hear their stories every year during Holy Week on Palm Sunday and Good Friday. Think of the characters who were part of the final moments of Jesus' life. Think of Pontius Pilate, his great struggle with the meaning of truth, with Jesus' innocence, and how many times we in our lives equivocate on the truth. Pilate, more than anybody, was the expert in moral relativism. What is truth? He knew what the truth was. The truth was sitting in front of him. And if he only engaged in dialogue with Jesus, things may have turned out differently. Think of Pilate's wife who storms in on him in Matthew's account and says, "Wait a minute, I had a dream. This man is innocent." Think of all of those feelings and emotions that were taking place. Think of Simon of Cyrene. We're told he was dragged in from the fields. He was just coming in after a long day of work. And they laid the cross on him and they made him carry it behind Jesus. And that word behind is key to understanding Simon's role. Simon didn't carry the cross in some kind of aimless wandering. He carried it following Jesus. When we carry our crosses, the big ones and the small ones, we carry them following Jesus in his footsteps. The mere fact of carrying the cross is not what's important, because many persons in this world suffer quite dramatically. Every people, every family, every country has huge burdens on their shoulders and sorrows and burdens to bear every day. But that which gives meaning and fullness to carrying the cross is to carry it behind Jesus. Think of the women who were weeping when they saw Jesus going by. Think of that beautiful figure of Veronica. Even though she's not a biblical figure, her story is not so much related to us in the scriptures, She represents a beautiful tradition. Vere Icona, her name is, the true icon, the true image. And she comes and put that cloth on his face, and Jesus leaves his imprint on the cloth. And Jesus does the same to us when we come to him with sincerity and with honesty. He leaves his imprint on the cross. That which gives meaning to the cross is to carry it behind Jesus. Ultimately, the Stations of the Cross and the Via Dolorosa, the Via Crucis, invite us to enter the mystery of Christ's passion. And they invite us to make some choices, to take sides, either for him or against him. Each of us has been marked by the sign of the cross. And the word of the cross, this powerful word, dwells within each one of us, freeing us and liberating us from a world of darkness, of alienation, of hatred. It welcomes us into a communion of light and peace. What is the cross? The cross that we're going to see tonight in these images and feel and experience? The cross is the triumph of God's love over the deepest sin, the darkest death, the ultimate evil. The cross is a word that burns into our consciousness a double insight. On the one hand, it shows human beings at our worst. It points out what we are sadly and ultimately capable of. The cross also reveals to us to what extent God will go out of love for us. Those who identify with the Via Crucis, with the way of the cross, with the Via Dolorosa, also identify with the willingness, the unwillingness to destroy and crucify. The question is not who killed Jesus at that particular time. We know who was responsible. Certain leaders of his own people decided to put him to death, but by no means did all of the Jews rise up and put him to death. Certain leaders, political and religious, didn't know what to do with him. But the real question we have to ask thousands of years later here in Madrid and in Sydney and in Toronto, what killed Jesus? And what vicious cycles of violence continue to make the Lord of life walk the sorrowful way in the women and men of our day? And what cycles and systems crucify him today in his sisters and brothers of the human family? In the portrayal of the images tonight that you will see that will come to us from the Recoletos, you will see oftentimes men in dark habits, long robes, with pointed hats or whatever. We should not be afraid of such things. This comes from the great ancient traditions of all of these towns here in Spain and not from other countries. And the men oftentimes are shielded like that, not to show that they're hiding, but to show that they're part of all humanity that was responsible of this. All of us were responsible for leading Jesus in these final steps. In the first station you're going to see, I want to highlight a couple things. It's the brotherhood of the Cofradía de Nuestro Padre Jesús Nazareno. It's a very ancient brotherhood of the confraternity. And they're going to carry a huge display sculpture of the Last Supper. Look carefully at the images when you see them. Look at the exquisite artwork, but look at the emotions on the faces of all of those people who gathered around Jesus in those final moments at his last meal. Artists spent hours, years, in sculpting these. So these sculptures have been preserved sometimes for 200, 300, 400 years in the different towns where we got them from for this particular evening. You'll often notice the men either dressed in black robes that are carrying these sculptures, or they could be wearing purple. And they're all part of the whole tradition of the confraternities that grew up in these native places here in Spain, in each town. And each group will be quite different. How do we approach this ourselves tonight? First of all, the prayers will be in different languages. All of the pilgrims have the Magnificat book in their various languages. And the speaker system that's set up throughout the city will have a script and the soundtrack so people can join in the singing. And if all goes well as planned, the opening song to begin the whole ritual that they've chosen tonight is the Song of the Cross. At least that's what's in our script. And this beautiful Song of the Cross was the song that we developed in Canada as the World Youth Day Cross made its way around the country in 2001 and 2002. Just give you one little recollection of those magnificent moments of the cross as it crisscrossed our huge country in Canada. We made sure that the World Youth Day Cross, which is really at the centerpiece of tonight's celebration, we wanted everyone to have an opportunity to touch that cross and venerate that cross. And we insisted that the cross visit not just churches and the places where people gather for worship, but the cross went into detention centers and jails in every city. It visited nursing homes and places of great suffering. It visited places where tragic accidents had taken place. And as we were going through this for the year before World Youth Day, the event of September the 11th happened and had such catastrophic effects in Pennsylvania, in Washington, and especially in New York City when the towers came down. The place is known as Ground Zero. One of the most moving moments of that cross experience for me was we asked permission of the Holy Father, John Paul II, to take the cross into the pit at Ground Zero. And in February of 2002, accompanied by 100 young people from all over Canada, by our bishops, and by the representatives of the fire department, the police department, emergency medical services, we went on pilgrimage carrying the cross to New York City in the winter, in the cold winter. We're met at the bridge to New York City by all of the New York Fire Department and police and emergency medical people, and went in procession and carried the cross into the pit. And we brought with us some of the victims and their families, the families of the victims of the September the 11th tragedy. And there in the midst of death, real devastation, we stood with that cross and we sang the Song of the Cross. It was a moment I shall never forget. Because in the midst of tragedy and devastation and destruction, only God can bring good out of such evil, such horror, such terror. We're about to switch to the live feed, which will be coming to us in a few moments. You just have your Magnificat book in your hands, and we'll join the live presentation that's taking place in the streets of Madrid. Following the presentation this evening, I will read to you in English the Holy Father's remarks, which have been sent to us from the Vatican. So the Song of the Cross will be the first song, and then one of the refrains that will be sung is a beautiful refrain from Taizé. I'm going to sing it once, and perhaps we can join in, and then especially when we see it on the screen.
Misericordias Domini in eternum cantabo. Misericordias Domini in eternum cantabo.
It's one of the refrains we'll hear throughout. And the second refrain, which many of you know, I know, is Jesus, remember me, another refrain from Taizé.
Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom.
Together.
Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom.
So please join in when we see the crowd singing and the bishops and the cardinals and the Holy Father joining this as well. I would ask that you refrain from applause. We'll keep this a prayerful environment. We're in a special church tonight here in the Palacio de Deportes. Perhaps you want to think of a person or some persons now in your life who may be bearing a very heavy cross, a cross of sickness, suffering, of separation, of divorce, of loss, of sadness. And let's bring those people to the feet, the arms, and the hands of Jesus tonight. I'm going to stop talking now, and then we'll go to the live feed as soon as the signal is sent to us. It's just going to appear on the screens. I want to thank you very much for being with us this evening, and I will join you at the end of this broadcast.
So a special thank you to Father Tom. He is inside the Palacio de Deportes on the main stage. There are about 4,000 young people in there watching tonight's event on the large screens. Maybe it's a little bit, Father Chris, we can explain a little bit in more detail about what we're about to see tonight. In terms of these floats or pasos, these statues.
Yeah, and I think it's important as we prepare ourselves to just have a sense of the people, the confraternities that Father Tom mentioned, the brotherhoods that exist. I mean, these really are people that they do this with great humility. Many times people with the brotherhoods, you'll have many brotherhoods within a single city throughout the country of Spain. And they, this is a part of their heritage. Often it stays within the family, and then there are waiting lists that may be there. And each one of these brotherhoods has a chaplain to it. And so the acts, each brotherhood has different customs that as they carry these pasos, these floats, if you
right,
will.
Right. And this is a very typical Spanish thing, and certainly there's a little bit of a carryover in Latin America, that we have processions with these either statues, or the statue is in a more elaborate paso. I mean, that's right, really right. The word. It's not really a float, and it's carried like they're not on wheels. They're literally carried by these members of the confraternity or the cofradías, and you will see that. So that's a very Spanish tradition, and it's very different than the some of the other ways, World Youth Day ways of the cross that are more kind of prominent in our memory, like Toronto and Sydney.
And again, you will see different, these brotherhoods have different, some of them have different types of garments, and some of them will walk on bare feet, and others will have shoes, and so they all have different traditions, but these are all very prayerful elements, and it really is a great honor to be present to this.
Now the Holy Father has arrived, and he's being again greeted by some dignitaries, people from the or people that work in the with the mayor and in the municipality of Madrid. But it is a liturgical celebration, which is why you see the Holy Father is being vested. Some of us, at least my generation, don't remember in previous World Youth Day with Pope John Paul II of him actually being present at a Way of the Cross because of his old age. So it's, for me, very moving to have the Holy Father be able to be part of the celebration. As you will see tonight, he will be very much leading the celebration with an opening prayer and it's not really a homily, but some words of encouragement.
Interesting to note while the Holy Father continues to make his way up is that the confraternities, some have multiple pasos and some have only one. So there's different, and that often coincides with kind of different spiritualities that are at the center of each of these confraternities and brotherhoods.
Absolutely. It's not necessarily they've assembled the apostles to tell the story of the Stations of the Cross, but the apostles don't always only represent Stations of the Cross. In fact, tonight we will see 14 stations, but 15 pasos.
Correct.
Because we will conclude with a special paso that is going to commemorate Our Lady.
Spiritus Sancti.
Amen.
Pax vobis.
Et spiritu tuo.
Queridos jóvenes, nos reunimos aquí.
Dear young people, we are gathered here remembering the evening of Good Friday to walk with Jesus, the Son of God, in the mysteries of his dramatic and glorious passion. These are mysteries of life and salvation. Mysteries that reveal to us the love of Christ, He who loved us till the end. He who loved us as far as giving His life for us. The contemplation of the mysteries of Christ is an act of intense prayer that allows us to unite ourselves to Christ and with Him, opening ourselves to His love and joining ourselves our crosses to His. Love is made tangible in compassion. For that reason, at the same time that we contemplate the passion of Christ, we make present the suffering of so many brothers and sisters of ours who, as consequence of sin, whether it be personal or of others, travel through huge ways of the cross with the danger of losing their faith and hope. Today we want to make ourselves Cyreneans, like Simon, who, embracing the cross of Christ, welcome also in the prayer and in the charity the pain of our brothers and sisters. Stage area, the main procession area. It is carried by young people of different continents and different backgrounds. And the way the World Youth Day Cross will travel or journey in front of all 15 pasos of Holy Week. Of the Way of the Cross that we are going to be listening tonight has been composed by the Sisters of the Cross congregation, Las Hermanas de la Cruz, and has been composed also in song.
La última cena.
first station is the Last
Supper.
Then he took the bread, said the blessing, broke it, and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which will be given for you. Do this in memory of me." And likewise, the cup, after they had eaten, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which will be shed for you." Before taking the bread in his hands, Jesus welcomes with love all who are seated at his table. He doesn't exclude anyone, not even the traitor or the one who will deny him, nor those who will flee. He has chosen them now as the new people of God. They are the church called to be one. Jesus dies to gather into one the dispersed children of God. I pray not only for them, but also for those who will believe in me through their word, so that they may all be one. Love strengthens unity, and he says, love one another. Faithful love is humble. You ought to wash one another's feet. United in the prayer of Christ, we pray that in the Holy Land the Church may live united and in peace, that all persecution and discrimination because of the faith may cease, and all who believe in one God may live in justice and fraternity until God grant us the grace to sit together at his table. Cross is being passed over to a different group of young people. This is a group of young people from the Holy Land that will carry the cross to the next paso. We didn't get a chance to see much of the actual paso of the Last Supper. It's a paso that dates to the 18th century, the Baroque period, representing the Last Supper by the artist Francisco Salzillo Alcaraz. And the confraternity that carries the paso is the Cofradía de Nuestro Padre Jesús Nazareno, or the confraternity of our Father, Jesus the Nazarene.
Second station, Judas betrays Christ with a kiss. So he dipped the morsel.
Se acercó a Jesús y le besó, pero Jesús le contestó, amigo,
and handed it to Judas, son of Simon the Iscariot. After he took the morsel, Satan entered him. Immediately he went over to Jesus and he kissed him. Jesus answered him, "Friend, do what you have come for."
En verdad os digo que uno de vosotros me entregará. Judas se siente mal. Su ambición ha cambiado a precio de traición.
The breeze of the sacred mystery can be felt in the Last Supper. Christ is serene, pensive, suffering. He had said, "I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer." And now quietly, he lets his deepest sentiment escape. "Amen, amen, I say to you, one of you will betray me." Judas feels bad. His ambition has traded the price of betrayal. The God of love for the idol of money. Jesus looks at him and turns aside. Jesus calls his attention, offering bread with sauce. And he says, "What are you going to do? Do quickly." Judas' heart has begun to tighten. He goes to count his money before handing Jesus over with a kiss. And Christ, feeling the coldness of the traitor's kiss, doesn't reproach him, but says, "Friend, if you are feeling in your flesh the coldness of betrayal or terrible suffering provoked by division between brothers and fratrial fighting, turn to Jesus. He, being kissed by Judas, made all painful betrayals his own."
And the second paso is from the 1960s, from the region of Malaga. The confraternity that carries it is the Cofradía of Nuestro Padre Jesús del Prendimiento y María Santísima del Gran Perdón. The young people carrying the cross are a group of young people from Iraq. Third station, the denial of Saint Peter.
Et benedicimus tibi, quia per sanctam crucem tuam redemisti mundum.
Con que darás tu vida por mí?
Will you lay down your life for me?
En verdad te digo,
amen, amen, I say to you, the cock will not crow before you deny me three times.
Un cristiano.
A Christian has to be brave, and to be brave doesn't mean not to fear, but to know how to conquer fears. A brave Christian doesn't hide in shame from manifesting his or her faith in public. Jesus warned Peter, "Simon, Simon, behold, Satan has demanded to sift all of you like wheat, but I have prayed that your own faith may not fail. I tell you, Peter, before the cock crows this day, you will deny three times that you know me." And the apostle, for fear of some servants, denied him, saying, "I do not know him." As Jesus was passing through one of the courtyards, he saw him. Peter trembles, remembering his words, and cries with bitterness over his treachery. The gaze of God changes the heart, but no one has to let oneself be looked upon. Looking at Peter, the Lord has turned his eyes toward those Christians who are ashamed of their faith, who have human respect, but lack courage to defend life from its beginning until its natural end, or those who want to be admired according to the criteria that aren't those of the gospel, so that, like Peter, they recover their courage and become convinced witnesses of what they believe. Cross is now being handed over to a group of young people from Spain.
estación, Jesús es sentenciado a muerte.
The fourth station, Jesus is sentenced to death.
Et benedictimus
Divi, he deserves to die.
Quia per sanctam crucem tuam redemisti mundum.
Entonces se lo entregó para que
then
lo
they handed him over to be crucified.
La mayor injusticia es condenar
the greatest injustice is to condemn an innocent and defenseless person. And one day, evil judged innocence and condemned it to death. Why did they condemn Jesus? Because Jesus took upon himself the pain of the world. When he became flesh, he assumed our humanity and with it the wounds of sin. Their guilt he shall bear in order to cure us through the sacrifice of the cross. A man of suffering, accustomed to infirmity, he surrendered himself to death. What is most remarkable is Jesus' silence. He doesn't exonerate himself. He is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. He was whipped, crushed, sacrificed, but he was silent and opened not his mouth. In God's silence, all innocent victims of wars are present, wars that demolish peoples and sow hatred that is difficult to cure. Jesus remains silent in the hearts of many people who quietly wait for God's salvation.
And this paso is a very well-known one. It's the Cristo de Medinaceli, or the Christ of Medinaceli. The artist is anonymous. But it's from here, from the city of Madrid. The confraternity is La Cofradía de Nuestro Padre Jesús Nazareno de Medinaceli. And the cross is now being carried by young people who come from places where Christians suffer persecution because of their faith. Fifth station, Jesus carries his cross.
Christe et benedictimus tibi, quia per sanctam crucem tuam redemisti mundum.
Y cargando el mismo con la cruz,
and carrying the cross himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull.
Cruz no significa madero.
The cross doesn't only mean a piece of wood. The cross is all that makes life difficult. Among crosses, the deepest and most painful is the one that is rooted in the inside of a person. It is the sin that hardens the heart and perverts human relationships. For from the heart come evil thoughts, murder, adultery, unchastity, theft, false witness, blasphemy. The cross that Jesus carried on his shoulders to later die upon is the overload of all the sins of all mankind, my sins as well. He himself bore our sins in his body upon the cross. Jesus dies to reconcile all men with God. This makes the cross redemptive, but the cross by itself does not save us. It is the crucified one who saves us. He made the tiredness, exhaustion, and endurance of those who don't find work his own, that of the immigrants who receive unworthy or inhumane work offers, suffer from racist attitudes, or die in the effort to obtain a more just and humane life. And now the cross will be carried by young people from Madrid, accompanied by a group of immigrants. Titled Christ Falls on the Way to Calvary. The artist is Mariano Benigliuri. It is of the Baroque period and from the city of Úbeda in Jaén.
The sixth station, Jesus falls beneath the weight of the cross.
Adoramus te Christe et benedicimus tibi, quia per sanctam crucem tuam redemisti mundo.
Fue triturado por nuestros
He was crushed
crimenes.
For our sins. Jesus fell beneath the weight of the cross various times on the path to Calvary. Sacred Scripture doesn't make any reference to Jesus falling, but it is logical that he would lose his balance many times. The loss of blood because of the scourging which tore the skin, the unbearable muscular pain, the torture of the crown of thorns, the weight of the wood, words are not enough. We have all experienced tripping and falling to the ground. How quickly we get back up so as not to make a show. Contemplate Jesus on the ground and all those around him with ironical looks. See him receive one kick after another so that he would get up on his own. How they ridicule him. What humiliation, my God. The psalm says, but I am a worm, hardly human, scorned by everyone, despised by the people. All who seek me mock me. They curl their lips and jeer. They shake their heads at me. Jesus suffers with all those who trip over stones and fall victim to alcohol, drugs, and other dependencies that make them slaves, so that supporting themselves in him and in those who come to their aid, they may get up again. And now the cross will be carried by young people freed from drugs.
To the next paso, titled Nuestro Padre Jesús Nazareno, Our Father Jesus Nazarene. It is from the confraternity of Dulce Nombre de Jesús Nazareno from the city of León. It requires 94 people to carry it.
Thank you.
séptima estación,
seventh station,
el Cireneo ayuda a Jesús,
Simon of Cyrene helps Jesus to carry his cross.
Adoramus te Christe et benedicimus tibi, quia per sanctam crucem tuam redemisti mundum.
As they led him away, they took hold of a certain Simon, a Cyrenian, who was coming in from the country. Simon was a strong young farmer who was coming from his work in the fields. They forced him to carry the cross of our Lord, moved not by compassion, but out of fear that Jesus would die on the way. Simon resisted, but the soldiers were implacable in their insistence. He had to accept under coercion. In contact with Jesus, the attitude of his heart starts to change, and he ends up sharing the situation of that stranger who was being executed, who in silence carries a weight heavier than his weak strength can bear. How important it is that we Christians discover what is happening around us and realize that there are people who need us. Jesus felt alleviated by the help of the Cyrenian. Thousands of youths of all races, conditions, and creeds, marginalized by society, daily encounter Cyrenians who know how to embrace the cross with abnegation and walk beside them with generous self-giving. Paso is titled La Veronica. The artist is Francisco Pinto. The confraternity is La Cofradía, La Hermandad del Santísimo Sacramento del Altar y Cofradía de Nazarenos de Nuestro Padre Jesús de las Misericordias, María Santísima de la Candelaria y Santa Mujer. From the city of Jerez de la Frontera. This paso requires 35 men to carry it.
Octava estación.
Eighth station. Veronica wipes the face of Jesus.
Adoramus te Christe et benedicimus tibi, quia per sanctam crucem tuam redemisti mundum.
A large crowd of people followed Jesus, including many women who mourned and lamented him. Jesus turned to them and said, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me. Weep instead for yourselves and for your children." A large crowd of people followed Jesus, including many women who mourned and lamented him. Jesus said, turned to them and said to them, "Do not weep for me. Weep instead for yourselves and for your children. Cry not with sad weeping that hardens the hearts of and predisposes one to produce new crimes. Cry with soft weeping that cries out to heaven, begging for mercy and forgiveness." One of the women, moved on seeing the Lord's face filled with blood, dirt, and spit, crossed violently through the soldiers until arriving at Jesus. She took off her headscarf and wiped his face gently. A soldier drew her back violently, yet looking at the headscarf, she saw that Christ's bloodied and suffering face was traced upon it. Jesus is moved to compassion on seeing the women of Jerusalem, and in Veronica's cloth leaves an image of his face, which calls to mind that of so many men and women who have been disfigured by atheist regimes that destroy the person and deprive them of their dignity.
Carried by young people from Rwanda and Burundi. Paso is titled, Jesus is Stripped of His Garments. The artist is Manuel Ramos Corona. It is from the city of Granada. And the confraternity is La Cofradía, La Hermandad del Santísimo Sacramento, y Cofradía de Nazarenos de Nuestro Padre Jesús Despojado de Sus Vestiduras. María Santísima del Dulce Nombre y San Juan Evangelista. When being carried, this paso requires 48 men to carry it. Ninth station. Jesus is stripped off his garments. Then they crucified him and divided his garments by casting lots for them to see what each should take. While the executioners prepare the nails and the ropes to crucify him, Jesus remains standing. A soldier comes close and, pulling at his tunic, rips it off. The wounds began to bleed again, causing terrible pain. Then they divided his garments among them. Jesus is left naked in front of the masses. They have stripped him of everything, like an object of cruel jokes. There is no greater humiliation, no greater scorn. They have left him disarmed. Garments don't only cover the body, but also what one carries inside, his or her intimacy and dignity. Jesus went through this embarrassment because he bears the weight of all sins against integrity and purity, and died once in order to take away the sins of many. Jesus suffers with all those who are victims of human genocide, where brutal violence explodes, or victims of rape and sexual abuse, the crimes of children and adults. How many people are stripped of their dignity, of their innocence, of their trust in man? Next paso is titled The Crucifixion. The artist is Ramon Alvarez Prieto. from the late 19th century. It is owned by La Cofradía de Jesús Nazareno of the city of Zamora.
The 10th station, Jesus is nailed to the cross.
Adoramus te Christe et benedicimus tibi, quia per sanctam crucem tuam redemisti mundo.
When they came to the place called the Skull, they crucified him and the criminals there, one on his right, the other on his left.
Uno a la derecha y otro a la izquierda.
They had led Jesus to Golgotha. He didn't go alone, but accompanied by two thieves who would also be crucified. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus in the middle. What a graphic image. The Lamb who takes away the sin of the world becomes sin and pays for the rest. The great sin of the world is the lie of Satan. And they condemn Jesus for declaring the truth that he is the Son of God, the truth that is the argument that justifies the crucifixion. It is impossible to describe what Christ suffered physically in his body as he hung on the cross, what he suffered morally on being hung naked in between evildoers, and emotionally on finding himself abandoned by those who were his own. Jesus on the cross embraces the suffering of all those who live nailed in painful situations, such as parents and young people who, for lack of work, live precariously in poverty or desperation without the resources necessary to make their families pull through and live a dignified life.
The next paso is titled Santísimo Cristo de la Buena Muerte y Ánimas. The artist is Francisco Palma Burgos, and it is from the city of Málaga, owned by the cofradía titled La Real Congregación del Santísimo Cristo de la Buena Muerte y Ánimas y Nuestra Señora de la Soledad. When being carried, this paso requires 240 men to carry it.
Undécima estación, Jesús muere en la cruz.
11th station, Jesus dies on the cross.
Quia per sanctam crucem tuam redemisti mundum.
Jesús
Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Father, into your hands I commend my spirit." And when he had said this, he breathed his last. It was the Sabbath, the day of preparation for the feast of the Passover. Pilate authorized them to break the criminal's legs in order to accelerate their death, so that they might not stay hanging on the crosses during the feast. Jesus had already died, and a soldier, in order to make sure, thrust his lance into Jesus' side. For this happened so that the scripture passage might be fulfilled, "Not a bone of it will be broken." And again another passage said, "They will look upon him whom they have pierced." The sun was darkened and the veil of the temple was torn in two. The earth shook. This is a sacred moment of contemplation. This is the moment of adoration, when we place ourselves in front of the body of our Redeemer, lifeless, crushed, tortured, hanged, paying the price for our evils, for my evils. I have sinned. Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. Jesus dies for me. Jesus gains the Father's mercy for me. Jesus pays for all that I should have paid for. And what will I do for him? Before the drama of so many crucified people with different handicaps, do I fight to extend and proclaim the dignity of the person and the gospel of life? Next paso is titled El Descendimiento, or The Lowering. The artist is Luis Marco Pérez. It is owned by La Cofradía Venerable Hermandad del Santísimo Cristo de la Salud from the city of Cuenca.
The 12th station, Jesus is taken down from the cross. Pilate ordered the body of Jesus to be handed over. Taking the body, Joseph wrapped it in clean linen. Let us come close to the Virgin Mary and share her sorrow. Christ has died and has to be taken down from the cross. What must be going through her mind? Who will help me take him down? Where will I put his body? And she must have repeated what she had said in Nazareth, "Let it be done." But now she is more united to the unconditional self-giving of her sons, "It is finished." Then Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus appeared, who, though they belonged to the Sanhedrin, hadn't taken part in the death of the Lord, and had asked Pilate for the body of the teacher in order to bury it in a new tomb that was theirs, which was very close to Calvary. Christ had failed, making his own the failures of all humanity. The Son of Man had been eliminated, sharing the lot of those who, for different reasons, had been considered the dross of humanity because they didn't know better or aren't capable or seem to be unworthy. They are, among others, the victim of AIDS, who, with the wounds of the cross, hope that someone will take care of them.
young people from Sudan are taking the World Youth Day cross towards his apostle titled Nuestra Señora de la Piedad. The artist is Gregorio Fernandez. It's owned by La Cofradía Penitencial Nuestra Señora de la Piedad from the city of Valladolid. Thirteenth station. Jesus in the arms of his mother. And you yourself, a sword will pierce. Although we are guilty of the death of Jesus, in these sorrowful moments the Virgin Mary needs our love and closeness. Our consciousness of being repentant sinners will console her. With filial love, let us place ourselves at her side, and let us learn to receive Jesus with the tenderness and love with which she received the mangled, lifeless body of her son in her arms. Is there any suffering like my suffering? And as they prepare the body of the Lord for burial, according to the Jewish burial custom, Mary, adoring the mystery that she had kept in her heart without having understood it, deeply moved, repeats with the prophet, O my people, what have I done to you? Or how have I wearied you? Answer me. As we contemplate the sorrow of the Virgin Mary, we recall the sorrow and loneliness of so many parents who have lost their children because of starvation, while opulent societies, swallowed by the dragon of consumerism and by the perversion of materialism, are sunken in the nihilism of empty lives. Is being carried by a group of young people from Haiti. And they're carrying the cross towards the next paso, which is titled Cristo Yacente by Gregorio Fernandez from the city of Segovia. Like the group of Haitians, we're also joined by a group of Japanese young people representing all the peoples who are victims of natural disasters.
Decimocuarta estación.
Fourth station, Jesus is placed in the tomb.
Adoramus te Christe et benedicimus tibi, quia per sanctam crucem tuam redimisti mundum.
So they laid Jesus there because of the Jewish preparation day, for the tomb was close by, and Joseph of Arimathea rolled a huge stone across the entrance of the tomb and departed. Because the feast was close at hand, they hurriedly prepared the body of the Lord to be placed in the tomb that Joseph and Nicodemus offered. The tomb was new. No one had been buried there. Once the body had been placed there, Joseph had a stone rolled in place of the door. The entrance was totally closed off, unless a grain of wheat should fall into the ground and die. And after the noise of the rock closing off access to the tomb had ceased, Mary, in the silence of a striking loneliness, tightens her grip on the grain of wheat that she carries in her heart like the first fruit of a resurrection. With this grain of wheat, we remember the humble work and the sacrifice of so many lives spent in selfless sacrifice in the service of God and neighbor, who wait for fecundity united to the death of Jesus. We remember all good Samaritans who appear in every corner of the earth to share the consequences of the unleashed powers of nature, earthquakes, hurricanes, and tsunamis.
This concludes the Stations of the Cross, but there is one more paso titled Virgen de Regla. The artist is Luisa Roldán, and it is owned by La Hermandad del Prendimiento Los Panaderos from the city of Sevilla.
Thank you.
Now there is a brief moment as we contemplate the solitude of the Virgin Mary.
Dear young people, we have celebrated this way of the cross with fervor and devotion, following Christ along the path of his passion and death. The commentaries of the Little Sisters of the Cross, who serve the poor and the most needy, have helped us enter into the mystery of Christ's glorious cross, wherein is found God's true wisdom, which judges the world and judges those who consider themselves wise. We have also been assisted on this journey to Calvary by our contemplation of these wonderful images from the religious patrimony of the Spanish diocese. In these images, faith and art combine so as to penetrate our hearts and summon us to conversion. With faith's gaze is pure and authentic, beauty places itself at its service and is able to depict the mysteries of our salvation in such a way as to move us profoundly and transform our hearts, as Saint Teresa of Jesus herself experienced while contemplating an image of the wounded Christ. As we were making our way with Jesus towards the place of his sacrifice on Mount Calvary, the words of Saint Paul came to mind. Christ loved me and gave himself for me. In the face of such disinterested love, we find ourselves asking, filled with wonder and gratitude, what can we do for him? What response shall we give him? St. John puts it succinctly, by this we know love, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. Christ's passion urges us to take upon our own shoulders the sufferings of the world in the certainty that God is not distant or far removed from man and his troubles. On the contrary, he became one of us in order to suffer with man in an utterly real way, in flesh and blood. Hence, in all human suffering, we are joined by one who experiences and carries that suffering with us. Hence, consolatio is present in all suffering, the consolation of God's compassionate love. And so the star of hope rises. Dear young friends, may Christ's love for us increase your joy and encourage you to go in search of those less fortunate. You are open to the idea of sharing your lives with others, so be sure not to pass by on the other side in face of human suffering. For it is here that God expects you to give of your very best, your capacity for love and compassion. The different forms of suffering that have unfolded before our eyes in the course of this way of the cross are the Lord's way of summoning us to spend our lives following in his footsteps and becoming signs of his consolation and salvation. To suffer with the other and for others, to suffer for the sake of truth and justice, to suffer out of love and in order to become a person who truly loves, these are fundamental elements of humanity, and to abandon them would destroy man himself.
al hombre mismo. Que sepamos acoger estas lecciones y llevarlas.
Let us eagerly welcome these teachings and put them into practice. Let us look upon Christ hanging on the harsh wood of the cross. And let us ask him to teach us this mysterious wisdom of the cross by which man lives. The cross was not a sign of failure, but an expression of self-giving and love that extends even to the supreme sacrifice of one's life. The Father wanted to show his love for us through the embrace of his crucified Son, crucified out of love. The cross, by its shape and its meaning, represents this love of both the Father and the Son for men. Here we recognize the icon of supreme love, which teaches us to love what God loves, and in the way that he loves. This is the good news that gives hope to the world. Let us turn our gaze now to the Virgin Mary, who was given to us on Calvary to be our mother, and let us ask her to sustain us with her loving protection along the path of life, particularly when we pass through the night of suffering, so that we may be able to remain steadfast as she did at the foot of the cross.
Now as we move to the last pasaje, we contemplate on the solitude of Our Lady. Our Mother and Our Lady, you who remained firm in the faith, united to the passion of your Son, at the end of this way of the cross, we place our heart and our gaze on you. Even though we are not worthy, we welcome you in our home, as did the Apostle John, and we receive you as mother, as our mother. We walk with you in your solitude, and we offer you our companionship to continue sustaining the pain of our brothers and sisters who, in their flesh, complete what is missing in the Passion of Christ for his body, which is the Church. Look at them with the love of a mother, wipe away their tears, heal their wounds, and increase their hope, so that they may experience always that the cross is the way to glory, and that the passion is the prelude to the resurrection.
Amen. Dominus vobiscum,
et cum spiritu tuo,
sit nomen Domini benedictum,
sofinum et suecetum,
adiutorium nostrum in nomine Domini, benedicat vos omnipotens Deus, Pater et Filius, et Spiritus Sanctus.
Amen.
And that concludes tonight's celebration of the Way of the Cross, the Way of the Cross from Madrid, 2011, the 26th World Youth Day.
Stage, there are a few things I think that are worth noting that we really didn't have a chance to discuss or talk about or make mention of. It really is a part of the tradition of these pasos, and we certainly didn't want to take away from the meditative aspect that is the Way of the Cross. But you know, it's interesting that many of these confraternities make a tradition of pardoning prisoners as part of their part of Holy Week when they celebrate these things. Many of them also provide scholarships to seminarians and to other people. There are also lots of different charities that are done. And so it's not just there is this element of prayer, but then there is also this real aspect of charity and service that goes along with these brotherhoods. And I think that is something we would all want to keep in mind, because really they all say that the meditations and the spiritualities of these different groupings, or of these mysteries, lead us into service, and that has been a very large part of the themes of this World Youth Day.
And it was very apparent in the groups of young people that were carrying the World Youth Day cross, whether it was victims of natural disasters or
people suffering from AIDS,
from persecution or from various diseases or disabilities. And it was also apparent in the actual text that was written by the sisters of
the cross.
Of the cross, inviting us to not forget about some of these groups that are quite often marginalized.
Right.
We cannot contemplate on the suffering of Christ and then ignore
the suffering
our brothers
of others
and sisters that are suffering. Yeah. Exactly.
And I think this is a good moment to simply ask for prayers for all of those who are watching at home or maybe listening in different locations. Prayers for the people of the city of Madrid and the people of Spain, because this is really a moment in World Youth Day's past, the Way of the Cross, when it's been done, where we really start to see a conversion of people who have probably kept a distance or kept themselves at a distance from the events of the World Youth Day and the pilgrims. And so simply to pray for an increase of hope and joy for all those who are watching. And really, this is a moment we've seen that happen in the past.
I'm thinking that quite often with... I grew up in a Latin American country where Catholicism is a given. And we have processions, and there are feast days and solemnities, and but people don't really understand what they mean. We're so used to celebrating them. So there's a procession, and we go. But it's not often that we're forced, maybe forced is not the right word, but encouraged or invited to participate in a religious tradition that calls us to make us aware of our brothers and sisters, that being a follower of Christ doesn't mean that we have these empty devotions. It means that we follow Christ to the cross and in service.
Well, and I think these particular stations also remind us that we do those things and we do them in public. And so this is, you know, this meditation is not something that is done just in the church or within the safe, you know, confines of the four walls of our buildings, but in World Youth Day, we bring this meditation out to the streets so that people, you know, who may not go into a church may have an encounter with Christ through the very mysteries of the Stations of the Cross.
It is, and it's impossible to ignore when there are 500,000 young people out in, you know, road closures. And again, something that superficially might look like a regular Catholic devotion or tradition, but is very much something that is not a regular tradition.
No.
And all these young people who are interested in these Catholic devotions.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and they really do have a chance to be able to, again, embrace them, perhaps in a way that, you know, I think we get so used to seeing them in a in kind of a from a common vantage point. You know, like I can think of the Stations of the Cross as I'm used to seeing them in a North American context, and seeing them, and I really have to say, I mean, these pasos are quite impressive, and what you really didn't have a chance to see in some of the videos is really some of the detail. If when you go onto the websites of these different brotherhoods, they have unbelievable types of artistic explanations. Every single detail on these things matters. And we're just not used to, I think, kind of really staying and meditating on each one of these mysteries.
No, we're not. And if there was anything that I wish had been a little different, at least for us watching on television, is that the artistry, the perfection of the artistry that really invites you to contemplate on the mystery, and whether it's looking at the hands of Jesus or looking at the face of Simon of Cyrene, and just maybe nothing speaks to you, but just contemplating on that element of the statue or of the scene is probably all you need.
Well, one such example is that, you know, the station of when Jesus falls, they made a special point about the fact that Jesus' hand was outstretched as if to catch himself, and how often we want to do that, to save our own kind of pride or our own ego, and yet we fall nevertheless. And so there are all kinds of meditations that go much deeper than just the surface level, and that really is a testament to the depth of faith. We can always go deeper. We can always spend more time reflecting on these things, these elements. Every single mystery has a depth that really reaches far beyond our imagination.
I guess that's what makes it the Word of God.
Right.
The Word of God that is alive and speaking to us no matter where we are, who we are. And you might contemplate on the mysteries of the Station of the Cross every day for the rest of your life, and every day would be a different meditation.
It's probably worth noting, just to give people back home an idea, that it's about 100 degrees or 37 degrees right now on these streets of Madrid, and so some of these people have been lining up for quite some time, but this again is a very warm day in Madrid, and so they probably did experience a bit of the suffering on the Via Crucis themselves this evening.
It doesn't look like it's bothering people very much, even though with the solemn nature of the Stations of the Cross, you still have the cheers, the chanting, the hundreds of thousands of people that we see that are there with their flags, and they're not there just because the Pope is here and they want to see the Pope. They're there because it's a celebration of the Way of the Cross.
That's right, and a celebration of the Abhorred, because it's the happy fault of the cross. I mean, you know, this is we are united with Christ because of this path, and it's a path we all must follow, and it's a path that we know we will eventually share in His glorious resurrection as well. So there's always a bit of, while we are mournful for our own sinfulness, we are also rejoiceful. We rejoice because of the promise that we know will be fulfilled.
Which is why it is not a coincidence that in his wisdom, Pope John Paul II began the World Youth Days by giving a cross to the young people of the world. Very much so, the cross is the symbol, well, it's a symbol of our faith, but it's a symbol of World Youth Days. And maybe tonight is the first night, this is the third main event that we've had, but tonight is the first night that we've seen the World Youth Day cross, really, as a participant.
Yeah, it looks like the Holy Father is now taking a path, you know, really through all of the apostles, and it is giving us all a chance to be able to look on them a little bit more, which I know I certainly appreciate as well.
Yes, he's driving past. You can see the view of how the apostles, the stations are spaced out, and the Holy Father, as he drives away, will have a chance to look at them closer. We've been just told by the spokesperson of the Spanish Episcopal Conference that the Spanish Conference estimates 1.5 million people at this event tonight.
Wow.
So here we can appreciate the members of the cofradías as they stand with their apostle.
Interesting, as I was doing a bit of the preparation and looking at all the different websites for each of the brotherhoods, many of them have blogs, you know, and have been calling out for volunteers, and you can really see the true honor and excitement of each of these brotherhoods as they were able to participate in this World Youth Day with the Holy Father and so many youth from around the world.
Absolutely. I remember when we arrived our first Sunday here, we had a chance to celebrate Mass at a Franciscan parish in downtown Madrid, which is the parish of the Christ of Medinaceli, and that is the home of one of the apostles that we saw. I believe it was the fourth station, a very famous image of Christ, the Christ of Medinaceli, and it's a statue that is regularly housed. I guess housed. This is where it's the home of the apostle, and people come regularly into the church to share a prayer or a practice of devotion to the statue.
And that particular Paso has some very interesting history to it as well. I mean, part of this tradition, which occurs on the first Friday of March every year, people go to venerate that particular image, and they make three requests, and they write those requests down, and they're not allowed to be for themselves. They have to be for other people. And so the parish has actually started an online version of this, and there are over 6,100 messages that have been received, and you can actually go onto the parish website and view all of these different prayer requests for so many different people. And the other piece of information that was really I found quite interesting is that the story goes behind that particular paso. This gives you an idea of some of the history that accompanies each one of these pasos, but this is one example, that the image was commissioned by the Capuchin friars, and it was captured by an army. And so the king of the army ordered that image to be dragged through the streets as a sign of hate for the Christian religion. And it was the father of the Order of the Holy Trinity, a friar, who had risked his life asking the king to save the image. And he managed to convince the king to give back the image in return for his weight in gold. And legend says that the scale balanced exactly when 30 coins were placed on the scale, which is the same amount that Judas received for betraying Jesus. And at first time, this image was known as Jesus of the Ransom. for that reason. And we pass by it at this time.
We mentioned last night that with the Way of the Cross begins a sort of World Youth Day Triduum. The Way of the Cross on Friday, remembering, and the Holy Father began his opening prayer remembering the evening of Good Friday. And then tomorrow, Saturday, is a day of a pilgrimage, as the young people will walk pilgrimage towards the site of the last two events, the vigil and the closing mass, which will take place at an Air Force base, the base of Cuatro Vientos, an airport. So they will walk tomorrow and then hold vigil.
Mm-hmm.
Part of the vigil is celebrated with the Holy Father, and we will televise that. But probably the larger part of the vigil is not televised, as young people stay overnight at outside, sleeping outside. There are adoration tents set up outside, confessionals, and all kinds of other...
Right, and there's a prayer service that the Holy Father then leads as well, and is a huge part of the evening. And the vigil really is a special time, and I know I certainly look forward to kind of seeing that as well.
Yeah, I think for a lot of people, the vigil, in many ways, is the highlight, although the highlight really is the mass the next day. In Toronto, the vigil was evening prayer. So the devotion of evening prayer was introduced. A lot of young people are not familiar with that prayer of the church. And in Cologne, the element of adoration and benediction was introduced, which was carried over into Sydney. And tomorrow night we'll see how they've incorporated all these elements into the vigil that will be celebrated here at Cuatro Vientos Air Force Base in Madrid. Now, as the Holy Father leaves the site, many of the pilgrims, I'm sure, will remain if they haven't had a chance to get a good look at all the pasos. The pasos will remain. I'm not sure if at their current site, but they will remain at a different site where people can look at them and pray with them.
Mm-hmm.
But there are also youth festival events. Continue. The Holy Father is now saying hello to a little girl.
He's done this a couple times now. I've noticed he's stopped and said hello a couple different times. Well, some may be staying there. There are certainly pilgrims behind our studio set now that are beginning to, you know, walk behind us. And it looks like they're. I know I talked with many of the some or not many some of the. The different adult organizers, and they had all talked about how they were trying to be prepared for the vigil tomorrow and take care of the necessary things that they needed to do.
Yes. And I'm not sure if they're going back to where they're staying, or there are youth festival events happening here at the Palacio. We can hear there's already some music has begun. Because there were, like we said earlier, about 3,000-4,000 young people watching the Stations of the Cross right here from the main stage.
Right.
But I think this is going to conclude our coverage tonight. Tomorrow morning, if you're watching us online at worldyouthdaycentral.org, our coverage begins bright and early with the U.S. National Gathering, from the American Bishops Conference for All American Pilgrims.
Right.
And that's going to be at 9 in the morning, live from Madrid, if you're watching online. if you're watching us on our digital network, our digital cable network in Canada, it'll also air at 9 in the morning Eastern Time, at 6 in the morning Pacific Time. And tomorrow the Holy Father also will celebrate a Mass with seminarians, something that he began right. in Cologne okay. and has done at every World Youth Day since then. And that's going to air at 10 a.m. Madrid time if you're watching online. And then, of course, the vigil tomorrow night, Saturday. Our coverage begins at 7:30 local time, Madrid. Again, if you're watching at wydcentral.org. If you're watching on television at Salt and Light Television, it's going to air at 1:30 live, 1:30 p.m. Eastern. That's 10:30 a.m. Pacific time. You should check our website, saltandlighttv.org, for details on all that programming and the different time zones. And also, if you missed a portion of any of this programming or to watch any of the events, any of our coverage from World Youth Day, all the youth festival events that we've been airing, just go to wydcentral.org, and it's all there. And it's all there as well as with a lot of other stuff. So, Father Chris, thank you for being with us. Thank you for being with us. This has been Day 4 World Youth Day. World Youth Day Central. I'm Pedro Guevara Man.
Father Chris Valka, hasta mañana.